Welcome to End Time Talk Radio. We have a great show. We have Gary Kyle. Many of you have probably already heard him. It'd be a great show. Now, on November 16th of 2013, our church in Greeley, Colorado, had a prophecy conference. And at the time that was going, I overheard some people that were from Seattle, Washington, were talking about how they're actually hearing from, I think it was Department of Agriculture, somebody there was telling them how the starfish were actually melting from Fukushima, the water coming up on the western side of the United States, and also how park rangers were being affected by that. But I think you'll find that very interesting. That was at church when we did that. So you'll hear some background noise, and then we'll get right into Gary Kaw.
But it's through a friend of mine who's with the Department of Agriculture, and he was at Olympia, which is our state capital, probably 3 weeks ago, and it's being hushed. They don't want to be afraid of the panic. They're not only being killed right in front of Seattle, Elliott Bay is right in the bay, body of water.
Elliott Bay is right by the Space Needle.
Yeah, Space Needle, the football stadiums, all that. That's that body of water. The starfish aren't only being killed, they're melting right now.
And also, you said something about the park rangers were getting...
Park rangers of the
Washington and Oregon Olympic. Have been picking up most of the debris from that.
And it's killing them.
And of the seven, two of them died.
Really?
From radiation poisoning. This is what I'm hearing from my friends.
Sure.
And it's all being hushed. There's been online. You look up tuna and sockeye salmon. Those stocks are migrant between Japan and our coastline. They sampled 15 random tuna. Bluefin tuna, the big fish. Every one of them were radioactive.
Really?
Every one of them.
Welcome to End Time Talk Radio, where the truth is usually stranger than fiction. The purpose of these shows are not to scare you, but to prepare you, because what you don't know could hurt you. The word says in Hosea 4:6, "My people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge." Thank you for joining us. My name is Julie, and here is the host of the show, Barry Meyer.
Welcome to End Time Talk Radio. We have a great show today. This is one I've been really looking forward to for the last 6 months, and so things have worked out. And now we have Gary Kaw. Now, his website is called Hope for the World. You can get there by garykaw.org. Now, it's Gary, K-A-H.org. That's last name is K-A-H.org. Now, Gary Kaw is a former Europe and Middle East trade specialist for the Indiana state government. While in that position, he traveled extensively overseas, working closely with the economic staff at American Embassies and trade-related projects. During that time, he learned of efforts underway to establish a one-world political financial system. He also discovered there were religious and motivations connect to these endeavors. Also, Gary has written two good, really excellent best-selling books. One is called Into the Global Occupation and the New World Order, New World Religion. And let's see, I have the other one here, but I don't think I have it right up. What was the other book that you had written, Gary?
The other book, we merged that into the New World Religion. So really just Roots of Global Occupation, New World Religion, which was an expanded version. It's twice as long, and we've reproduced a bunch of documents in there. So those are the two books.
Okay, well, great. Now, with you being in the government and you, in that stance, maybe tell people about how you got there and how you found all these things that were happening now that we're seeing.
Well, I was young, and it was clearly something that God did. He opened up an incredible door. The state of Indiana needed a Europe and Middle East trade specialist, someone to help companies from Indiana to export their products more effectively, to try to create jobs back here at home. And the person who was in my job before me left and kind of left the administration high and dry, so to speak. So they needed somebody quick. They needed somebody who was fluent in German, which I happen to be. And I was prepared as well as I could be up to that point in time to deal with international marketing and economics. That was my background. And so next thing I knew, I was traveling all around the world working for the state of Indiana. But my meetings overseas were organized through our American embassies. And so I was on the payroll of our state government, but a lot of my dealings, pretty much all my dealings overseas, were through the federal government, through the, again, the commercial sections of the American embassies. And I learned a lot real quick when you spend 3 or 4 days at a time in each city working with the people at the embassies and also the business people they introduce you to. And a lot of the meetings over lunch and dinner, and you know, you do more than just talk about business. It's just one step further to talk about global economic developments and then political developments. And sometimes we'd also get into religion. And so it didn't take long before I realized that there was a move underway already at that time to gradually take the world in the direction of ultimately a type of world government system. Some people refer to it as the New World Order. And some of the people I met were in favor of this idea. Others were opposed to it. So I did hear both sides of the spectrum. But this opened up the fact to me that this was indeed taking place. And I remembered thinking, wow, if this is real and we are headed in this direction, and there were a lot of reasons for me to believe that we were, in fact, heading in that direction based on the things that I did learn, it sure sounds a lot like what the Bible says would take place in the last days. And so God used those events in my life to really seek his word and become a better student of the Bible. And I became convinced that, yes, indeed, we are living in the last days, probably the last generation. I'm not a date setter. Plenty of people have done that and failed miserably. I think we ought to stay away from that type of thing. But the Bible does give us the warning signs so that we would know when the time would come closer for the Lord's return and all the things that happen right before he returns. And I think we're getting right to that point. So anyway, back in the 80s when I was in that job, I did begin to take a stand regarding some of these developments. And excuse me.
Sure.
And so pretty soon my job was on the line. Someone from the administration asked me to keep a lid on it or else risk losing my job. And I couldn't believe that that happened. I was in good standing as far as my work performance goes and everything. But in praying over the next month about my decision of whether to stay or go, I remembered back to everything my parents went through. My father is from Croatia. He fled from the Nazis and the communists, becoming a refugee. He and his family pretty much lost everything they had, leaving their home place with bullets flying all around them. After the war, he went into Germany to try to get work during the post-war recovery period in order to save up money so he could come to America. And while in Germany, he met my mother, who grew up under Hitler. And her father, my grandfather, was very outspoken on Hitler, against Hitler and the Nazis, to the point where grandma and mom feared for his life and prayed for him daily. And eventually my parents got married. They came to the United States, and I was born over here in Ohio. But I grew up hearing the stories of what my parents went through during the war. And as I looked at what was beginning to take shape in this country, it is very reflective of what took place during the years of Hitler's ascent. This was back in the, you know, in the 80s already, things going on behind the scenes. Not so much within the Reagan administration, but some of the bureaucracies trying to move things behind the scenes. And of course, especially during the Clinton administration and years since, a lot of the plans that I learned about back then that were already underway are coming to fruition more quickly now. But I prayed about my decision back to my job with the state government, and I thought, man, with my background and everything I've learned from my folks and them fleeing what they did to come here to the U.S., for me to sit back and not say or do anything, I just couldn't live with myself. And so I took one more trip overseas that was already planned. It was with the Secretary of State of Indiana and a small group that he had put together, and I was one of the people invited. And on the way home from that trip, I was sitting in the airport in San Francisco, and God just gave me the words to write for a letter of resignation. And so I wrote that, handed it in when I got back, and gave the administration 3 weeks' notice. And and left my job and began researching and writing full time. And it took 6 years, but eventually it led to my first book, En Route to Global Occupation. And the rest is history. So that's kind of
yeah.
a long-winded answer, but that's just probably the tip of the iceberg still of everything that happened and went into it to lead me to write about this subject matter.
No, that's very good. You know, Proverbs 22:3 talks about, it says, a prudent person foresees danger and takes precautions. The simpleton keeps going on blindly and suffers the consequences. One of the things I'm seeing is that many in the church are so asleep that when you bring up anything about the last days, they almost go into like Novocaine it. They put Novocaine on, you know, like don't tell me about this stuff. Are you finding that more often too?
I do. There are some people coming around. People are kind of going into two groups right now within Christendom, within true Christendom. You've got false Christianity, a lot of things being taught that aren't scriptural. But in those circles of churches that are pretty doctrinally sound, I'm finding two groups, generally speaking. One group is seeing the signs, and they're getting ready. They get it. A larger group of people just don't want to face it. They're so much into the family life and just making it from day to day that it's almost more than they can handle. So rather than looking at it as an exciting time that we're headed into, a time of great faith that we need to walk closely with the Lord, there's an element of fear that comes in and they just shut down. And it's not that they don't believe in the Lord, that he died for their sins and paid the price for them, and that their eternity is secure in him. They believe that, but they don't want to go beyond that to the reality of what's taking place today and how it might affect them as Christians. And so I think some of these people, they're just going to get such a loud bang of a wake-up call when everything happens all at once that I am concerned for them. It's not that we have to dwell on the negative. That's not it at all. I don't get up every morning thinking about how I might be killed that day because of the stand I take for the Lord. That's not how it works. But I do believe we have to resign ourselves before the Lord that we are willing to pay the price, whatever it is, and we are going to walk in obedience with the Lord, and whatever he calls us to do and oppresses on our hearts, that's what we're going to do regardless. And so I guess it's a level of being sold out to the Lord. There's some that are just much more committed and ready to do anything, and they've died to themselves more than maybe the other group has that I'm describing, that is still operating somewhat in the flesh and just isn't willing to truly trust the Lord for everything. That's what I'm finding.
Yeah, you know, and we just moved ourselves out of the city. We're about by Cheyenne, Wyoming, and we're out in the county, and we're actually more or less trying to get more self-sufficient as we can. Now, with that being said, I had to go down to Colorado Springs with my work for schooling. With a new computer system, and I came across a guy that was former Navy from Romania at one time, and he told me that he was in Haiti when the earthquake went off, and he said it was a shell shocker for him because he was literally holding kids that actually had missing arms and legs, and they were dying, and he held them as they died, and he said, you know what, I was shell shocked, and the sad thing about it is that I believe that's what's going to happen to a lot of the church. You're going to be shell shocked because they're going to be in disbelief that this is actually happening.
Yeah, I agree with you. And the only question is, what is going to happen next in terms of major events that would shake things up? Is it going to be persecution of the church, or are we going to be hit by foreign enemies when we least expect it? I personally lean in the direction of believing that there's going to be severe persecution of Christians and also conservative Jews in this country in the not-too-distant future. And that will set the stage for other things to come. It's not going to be the same America that we've known and have come to love and cherish growing up. People can see the handwriting on the wall if they really want to. We're going through rapid change and almost some unbelievable things, really, that have happened in the last few years. I know when I was growing up, if you'd have told me in the 60s some of the things that have transpired recently, it would have been hard for me to believe that would really happen here. I'm talking about everything from same-sex marriage to, I mean, people would say, what? What's that? Yeah. You know, I mean, and here we are, and our leaders are endorsing this, and that's just, you know, one thing, one example. But we're moving away from a free America one based on a pretty strong Christian ethic, to more of a socialistic America, where even, you know, even among some of the constitutionalists out there, I went to a meeting a couple of years ago and I was shocked. There are about 105, 110 people there from all around the country representing the different states. Many Tea Party type people there, some leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And when it came time to pray and really acknowledge the Lord Jesus Christ, only about maybe 20 to 30 of them were willing to get on their knees.
Wow.
When called to do so. And in the mornings when we prayed, there were only about 10 to 12 people that showed up. And there was almost a complete absence of concern and of wanting to do God's will. And I'll be honest with you, I couldn't wait to get out of that place.
Mm-hmm.
There was such a darkness. And these were, quote-unquote, conservatives. And it was a wake-up call to me because I thought, wow, these people think they're going to save the country, and yet they don't want to know anything about Christ except for
yes.
a small minority of them there. And so you've got that on one end, and you've got the ultra-liberal establishment on the other end that's moving toward Marxism. And so I really don't see any major political answers in this country. It's got to be a spiritual turnaround, something like what took place in Nineveh, where there's an all-out repentance, where people just wake up and realize they've betrayed the Lord and ask for him to forgive them and get serious about walking with him and basically where we all throw ourselves at the foot of the cross. And so far, I just haven't seen any evidence of that happening. I see little pockets among a remnant, but that's about it. And so, you know, it doesn't give me a lot of optimism right now regarding the future of our country based upon what I'm seeing.
Well, you know, with that being said, one of the things I wanted to mention is my sister, I don't know, she might have got a warning from God. It could have been an angelic visit, and I'm going to share this. And if people actually want to read this, they can go to it's on Thursday, August 16th of 2012. The website is barry-julie.blogs.com. And Gary, what happened was she's actually studying to become a truck driver, and she came across a guy that was an airman in the Air Force base here at the air base here.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, they were sitting down talking, and he basically just started telling her that there's going to be certain things that are be coming down. One of the things that that he believed that the president, the current president we have now, will be reinstituted back into president for the 2012-13 election year, and that starting in 2013 there will be door-to-door searches, and that they find out that you have more than 3 months worth of food, they will be sending people to FEMA camps, and also that there will be a lot of specialized U.S. military troops being sent from the East Coast down to Colorado Springs and Denver area. The reason why I brought this up is that they do remember that they were 6 foot tall and different features, but when they went to find out what happened to that person, they had not shown up for a couple of days. The instructor said, I don't know who you're talking about. So I'm just saying that, you know, could this have been God maybe warning people that, hey, this is something that could be coming down next year?
It's very possible. Again, I don't want to set dates and make predictions because
sure.
only God, you know, he allows things to happen, and it doesn't happen till he's ready to allow them. And one thing I can tell you is that unless the nation repents, God, I believe, is going to be much more inclined to allow things happen. The one thing that might prevent it is if people truly get on their knees, cry out to God, and maybe he would give us some more time. But if not, I see a lot of things happening over the next 2 to 3 years. And I think if we were able to do the same program again a few years from now, look back to this moment in time, we would absolutely be stunned by everything that will have taken place between now and then.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, there was the preparation stage, there was the planning stage where things were still largely behind the scenes. And then around the year 2000, things began going more public because the powers that be felt strength in numbers, and they felt there were enough of them that they could begin to come out of the closet, so to speak, regarding some of these ideas. And now 2012, they're really pushing it hard. There's some major meetings coming up in October and again in December involving top occultists, New Agers, political leaders from around the world. A couple of the meetings are going to take place in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And they hope that those meetings will set the final stage so that they can lunge forward in the very near future and begin implementing their agenda. And that is fact. I know that those meetings are taking place. What I don't know is how quickly things will move forward from that point in time. Mm-hmm. And again, I have to look at the situation in this country and globally where we're at. I see us going off of a financial cliff early in 2013, at least in terms of the budget. Something's got to give. I mean, we are so far short of the money we need in this country. There's got to be a major change. You look at the Middle East, things are so tense in Syria. Israel surrounded. Iran almost has the nuclear bomb. Syria's got chemical weapons, and whether it's Assad or Hezbollah that ends up in control, it's a very dangerous situation. Israel's got Gaza to the west and Egypt now. Marzi, the new leader, has basically consolidated the military under his command by appointing his own leaders just last week. So things are shaping up in the Middle East for some type of showdown. And then politically, we have the elections coming up, and you have Putin taking charge in a major way in Russia, being a type of dictator really over there. And so the world is rapidly changing on all fronts, economically, in politics, as well as in religion. There's a real strong push for interfaithism, the coming together of the world's religions, and some of the meetings taking place this fall will have to do with that, because those pushing the global agenda realize they can't do it with much success unless they can somehow falsely unite the religions of the world. And so they're working feverishly on that part of it. That's kind of been their most difficult challenge. And so in the next 6 months, if they have their way, many of these things will reach a certain crisis point politically and in economics and in the Middle East with what's going on. I believe there are those people who actually want a crisis scenario, because they realize there are quite a few people in the world, especially in this country, who aren't going to go for major change unless they have to. You know, if the current system works, why go with something new?
Sure.
But if it looks as if it's going to come down and there's no way around it, and people are afraid of losing all their savings, the Social Security, everything else, then it won't take long before most people are on the bandwagon saying, hey, give us a new system. We don't care what it is, just so we don't lose our security and our way of life. And so I think that's where things are going. And your guess is as good as mine as to how low, how far they will allow things to collapse, if it's going to be a complete collapse or if it's just going to be a partial collapse to where people cry uncle pretty quickly and say, okay, we're on board. Let's, you know, do whatever we have to do. And so we're in that mode right now. I see the next 6 months or so rapidly unfolding with these, showing the real depth of these crises around the world and getting the world to begin to cry out for an answer. Mm-hmm. And at some point, I believe someone is going to step on the scene and they're going to look as if they're the world savior and that they have the answers, and it will be the Antichrist. But he will be very clever, and someone who the people of the world will go for, at least for a time. And so everything we're seeing right now is setting the stage for that. And I do believe we're in the final years, if not months, of that stage.
Yes. You know, and today is August 18th of 2012. One of the things I'm seeing, Gary, also with the crisis, is we're seeing the Mississippi River. We're seeing much drought. Matter of fact, family members out in Nebraska, what they would normally feed like towards like in January, February, the winter hay, they're already feeding the cattle now, the winter hay now, and which is almost 6 months ahead of time. We're seeing things getting exorbitantly, you know, more expensive. I could see a major crisis like that really hurting people quickly.
Well, that's true. And something else, a lot of our farms are now owned by foreigners. Many of these consortiums that control the chicken and beef industry, you know, I mean, you still have some private farmers, yes, but the bulk of those industries are now controlled by people that are loyal to the New World Order, and this is something most Americans aren't aware of. I have friends out in Kansas and Missouri and places like that, and the Chinese have come in and bought up a lot of land and companies, the Dutch, the Brits, I mean, the Japanese, you've got them from all over the world. And we are, to a growing extent, an owned country. We are owned by other powers now, and that's never been the case in our nation's history. And so a lot of Americans might think, well, we'll get our way out of this. You know, we've got all this land. We're not going to be that easy to conquer. Well, the problem is we've got so much debt, and we have to repay that debt somehow. I foresee a time when we might be growing food and having to export it to China or somewhere else just to pay our debt. And people might rebel against that, like a Boston Tea Party, say we're just not going to do it. But there will be ramifications then if we don't. You know, we'll be cut off from the rest of the world, and our cost of living would go way up because most of what we buy now in consumer goods is imported. So look for a doubling or tripling of those products within a year in price from the time all this starts, because most of them we can't even manufacture anymore in this country. That's a bad thing. We've given up our capacity to, in fact, if you look at the machine tool industry, which I work closely with when I worked for the government, I was helping them with exports, and we had a few good machine tool companies here in Indiana, but there are only a handful of them left in the country. Mm-hmm. And we used to use our machine tool industry to build the machines that we need to manufacture other things. That's what the machine tool industry does. It builds the machines that process and manufacture other items. Well, now, the last statistic I saw had over 80% of our machine tools being produced in countries like Taiwan and Mexico. And so if push came to shove, you know, we only have somewhere between 10 and 20% of the capacity we did 20 years ago to produce machinery to even make things in this country. Mm-hmm. And it would take a long time to pop out the machines that we would need to once again become a manufacturing country. So there are a lot of problems, and the New World Order crowd has tried to back us into a corner intentionally so that there doesn't appear to be a way out. And the number one thing that the American people have done to make it easy on them, or easier, I should say, is racking up the kind of debt that we have.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you've got an enormous amount of debt hanging over you, your lenders, they call the shots. And, you know, when you're $16 trillion in debt, we look at Spain and Greece, and yes, it's bad over there. And those under the age of 35 in Spain, the unemployment rate is approximately 50%, almost 50%. If that type of thing were to happen in this country, I'll tell you, there'd be rioting in the streets. There would be lawlessness in no time. And I believe it's coming, probably within the next 2 years or so, because the debt that we owe, percentage-wise, is not all that far behind where Spain is right now and Greece. It's just our credit rating has been better, and because we are the United States and still buy a lot of the products from other countries, although we're borrowing their money to be able to buy their own products with, and they're beginning to catch on to that now. So yeah. China is cutting way back on the money they're loaning us, and they're converting a lot of their reserves into gold. Because they see what's coming, and I'm afraid the United States is going to be left high and dry. And when all this hits the fan, people had better have a close walk with the Lord, because they're not going to be able to depend on much of anything else. I know in Oakland, California, and Camden, New Jersey, various cities around the country, they've already had to scale back the police and fire protection enormously because they're out of money.
Mm-hmm.
And the states are out of money, so they can't go to the states for help. And now the federal government is to the point where they're unwilling, in most cases, to loan out money. And, you know, I'm thinking a few more months, and this is going to start really gaining some momentum and going downhill quickly. I heard a story out of Chicago recently where the police up there, one of them had to go to like four or five gas stations before he could find one that would sell them gas.
Really?
Because the credit is so bad now of the police, because they're so far behind on payments, that they've been cut off from a lot of the gas stations. So, I mean, things that 15, 20 years ago would have been laughable, but now it's becoming increasingly frequent, you know. And
mm-hmm.
So they are interesting times, that is for sure.
You know, where we live out here in Wyoming, we feel insulated. I mean, if I go outside and I go to, like, when I went down to the Springs, the homeless numbers are quite up and different things like that. That's, you know, very interesting in itself. And one of the things I think I remember someone talking about is that even a lot of the water departments are owned by, like, what, by the French or some other European countries.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yes,
that's
correct.
That's amazing. What is that? 70% or greater now?
It's up there. I don't know the exact percentage, but I know the company that was managing our water company here locally in the Indianapolis area was a French company. I can't recall their name right now, but I learned of that a few years ago. They don't have actual ownership, but they have management control over it. And in some cases, I believe they may actually own it. But, yeah, you're right. Foreign investment groups have come over here and just bought up stuff left and right. And in the meantime, the average American owes so much money. And homes, you know, are being taken away from people for that reason, too, because home values have fallen. And so if somebody owes $180,000 on a house that was worth maybe $220,000, but now it's only worth $150,000, the banks can call in those loans. They say you no longer have the collateral to back up the value of the loan. And so I think the housing market is due for another wave of collapse. I mean, there's so many vacant homes right now, and there's another bubble getting ready to burst, because when you get all the federal and state employees and municipal employees that are going to be laid off because of a lack of funding, you're looking at hundreds of thousands, millions of people around the country that work for the government. They're going to be losing their jobs because they can't be paid anymore. And so they're going to be losing some of their homes. And then there are other people that are right on the bubble, too, where it takes both of them working to be able to, you know, make the house payment. If one of them loses their job, they're out in the cold. So I think 2013 is going to be a watershed year for that as well.
Mm-hmm.
And well, go ahead.
Oh, you know, one of the things I'm seeing a lot in the church is that Christism that's really happening, interfaithism. Can you touch on that?
Yes, interfaithism is a big part of all this, again, because you have to get the religions of the world together somehow if there's going to be a new world order and if the people of the world are going to be controlled. And the biggest obstacle, the single biggest obstacle within that realm has been getting Islam and Christianity together. But that is now happening. In fact, you have an entire movement called the Chris-Islamic movement, mm-hmm. where a number of Christian leaders, so-called Christian leaders, have gone out and spoken at major events with large numbers of Muslims and being invited even as keynote speakers to Muslim conferences. And it's not that I don't love the Muslim people. We have a Muslim backyard neighbor, and mm-hmm. there are quite a few Muslims in our neighborhood. And I am friendly toward them. I want to reach out to them. You know, you can't express concern for someone and truly love somebody and be concerned about their soul if you don't approach them at all. Mm-hmm. And Jesus did that, and there's nothing wrong with that. However, when you go to major conventions that promote the other religion, and you're going there as a Christian, and you're helping to provide a platform for that religion, that's what is now taking place. And so a lot of Christians are naively celebrating holidays, Muslim holidays like Ramadan and other events. And to me as a Christian, that simply crosses the line. At that point, you're beginning to practice another religion. And an Arab Christian friend of mine who's really on it, he's from Lebanon originally, and he shared a statistic with me some time back. He said that in the United States, for every one Muslim who converts to Christianity, who accepts Jesus Christ as a Savior, there are an average of 3 Americans who come from a Christian background who convert to Islam. It's a 3-to-1 factor. And so if we think we're going to win that battle, we're not. I mean, some people said, hey, bring it on. We'll just convert them all. No, it's not realistic. That's not how it happens. When you unleash Islam in America, you're going to have three times as many people from Christian backgrounds going over to Islam than the other way around. And that is happening now. It's happening all over the place, northwestern Ohio, southeastern Michigan. It's happening here in our own community. We have a mosque now at one end of our neighborhood and an Islamic school at the other end. And both of the buildings that they're using used to be churches, one a Lutheran church and one a Christian church. And some friends of ours, neighbors, have a firefighter friend locally here who shared with them that he had to go in and do a fire code inspection of the Islamic school just recently.
Mm-hmm.
And he said the people were very friendly. They walked them through the place. And then he said they got to a certain room, and then they got real quiet, and they tried to move him through the room as quickly as possible. And he said he looked around as they were walking. There was Nazi paraphernalia all over the place and Hitler paraphernalia, all that kind of stuff, anti-Semitic. This is 3.5 blocks from our house.
Wow.
Right here in the heartland. And most people don't have a clue. They live right next door to this place. So, I mean, obviously something's going on in there that's teaching hatred. And a lot of Christians, some Christians over the years, they've come to despise certain Jews because they realize there is a liberal element within Judaism that sometimes opposes Christianity. And so some Christians take the view, hey, what goes around comes around, let the Jews get what they deserve. You know, they take that attitude.
Yeah.
But, you know, in Germany, and my mom went through this over there, when persecution of Jews begins, persecution of Christians is right on the heels of that. And the Christians in Germany that didn't do anything, who didn't take a stand, by the time they woke up, it was too late. And many of them were carted off in a matter of a few days, and Germany was left largely leaderless. A lot of people from our country say, why didn't the Germans do anything? Well, what they don't understand is Hitler, with his henchmen, targeted a bunch of Christian leaders, and in a matter of a few days, coming into their houses at nighttime when they were asleep, they just hauled them off. It happened very quickly. And the rest of the people were then left kind of standing around like, what do we do now? Who's our leader? What do we do? You know, and so there was just a very limited opposition. And in this country, I think many people have fallen asleep too, and they don't realize what is going on right under our noses. And it's not just Islam, but all the different religions that have gotten a foothold in our country now that are moving us away from a Christian-based nation to one that now is predominantly interfaith. And we really are. We are not a Christian nation anymore. On that, yes. Obama was correct. He spoke the truth, ironically, on that. We are now an interfaith nation. Most people believe that there are multiple pathways to God, if they believe in God at all. And you've got maybe 10% possibly of solid Bible-believing Christians, and that would be probably on the high end. There are communities in the nation where it may be as high as 20 or more percent, but overall, I'd say less than 10%, and it's to the point now where, you know, if Christians don't see what's going on now, by the time they do wake up, it's going to be too late.
Yeah, and you know, the Joel Osteens and Benny Hinn won't come looking for us. They'll just keep preaching a more positive message all the time.
You know, what's interesting about all that is, if you read the Gospels, Jesus encouraged people, but he also rebuked people, and he did it pretty equally. I mean, if you read through the Gospels, he even got into some name calling. You know, he called the Pharisees whitewashed tombs, and called Herod a sly fox, and referred to some of them as a brood of vipers. And we don't like to see that part of Jesus, but he said it the way it is, and he rebuked his own disciples several times. And so what I'm saying is, the Christian walk, there's got to be a balance. There's times when we encourage people when they deserve to be encouraged and helped, but there are other times where we have to take a stand and say, no, this is not right. We need to take a stand on this and not just look the other way and just say positive, positive, positive. But that, Jesus didn't do that, and he's our foremost example. So who do we think we are to set ourselves up almost as small gods behind pulpits, just saying only the positive things that everybody wants to hear and respond to? People can't grow that way alone. Yeah, it is important that people are encouraged, and much of what Joel says is true. It's just he leaves out a lot of the other things that he needs to take a stand on.
Yes,
it preaches a one-sided gospel message, and it's not popular. You know, I mean, you're not going to be very popular if you take a stand like Jesus did. I mean, he wasn't. Look what happened to him, you know. And so a lot of the problem in America today is a lack of backbone among America's Christian pastors, and a lot of that began in the seminaries. One of the first things Satan did, and it's been a long time in coming, is he gradually got control of most of our seminaries, and they put out the pastors of tomorrow. And so you've got a lot of especially some of the younger pastors, 40 and under, out there now that are teaching interfaithism from their pulpits. And I know of one Bible school, it's still one of the more solid ones doctrinally in the country. We have a very close connection into that school. And that person, I have no reason to believe they exaggerated. They assured me that they weren't. Through firsthand experience, they said just under half of the seminarians studying to be pastors have a major pornography addiction problem. He knew this firsthand. And we've seen that also in other places. And these young men are going to come out, and they're going to be pastors in a matter of years, and they're addicted to pornography. It really is a mess, and Satan has been working overtime. But, you know, to try to turn the tables a little bit, it isn't all about Satan. He has been busy, it's true, but God is still in control, and he will have a final say. And what God is looking for right now is for a few good men and women who are willing to not compromise the fundamentals of the faith and are willing to be loyal to him at all costs, no matter what, and say, Lord, wherever you want me to go, whatever you want me to do, I will do it. I realize my life on this earth is short. Eternity is a long time. I want to work for an eternal reward, not for my own reward here for a few months or years, what's left on this earth. That's what we need right now. And I'm praying that people who are listening to this program, that you would feel convicted and go before the Lord yourself one-on-one and ask him to take control of your life and totally surrender everything to him and not hold on to any hidden sins or any secrets in your life, but to turn it all over to him, because he can use you in a mighty way and wants to do so. God's not done working with people yet. There are still going to be some opportunities, but you've got to surrender everything to the Lord.
Yes. That's really good to say, because I know for myself, when I listen to you or Rick Wiles or others that are warning the watchmen, I feel such an embrace. I feel, you know, I'm so drawn to it. And the hardest thing I find out, and it's just not just even Christians, but just even people that I work with, I'll mention something about a news story just to see if I can get a door open, and then just blow it off like, no, my life's doing great. And, you know, it's very superficial, and they don't want you to bring up anything that could be bad, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, no, I know. And that's been part of the desensitizing that's been going on, and the fact that people take our freedoms for granted. They just think it'll always be the way it's been because it's America. I mean, some people literally think that what has happened overseas in certain places, like in the Sudan and what's going on in Syria now and other places, that it cannot happen here. And that's the biggest prize the enemy has in their pocket, is that Americans are so arrogant, so many Americans mm-hmm. are, they think that it can't happen here. And Satan is counting on people thinking exactly that. And that's one reason it is going to happen. It's because the church, by and large, has gone asleep, and non-Christians, they already think they're invincible somehow, and they're just blinded and deluded. And, you know, Jesus said in Matthew 24 that there's going to be much deception in the last days, that even the elect would be deceived if that were possible. And Paul in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 also talks about a powerful delusion coming that would deceive people in a major way in the last days. And I think we're seeing the beginnings of that now. And it's going to be very important in the days ahead that we pray for discernment and are walking closely with the Lord and being in tune with him, because we, no matter what kind of head knowledge you have about the Lord, unless it's a relationship and you're walking with the Lord Jesus Christ, I think people are just going to get swept away. They're going to be blown away by what's about to happen.
Yes, and you know, and I know that if it's not about Jesus Christ, this radio show does not go on. I mean, it's not about me, it's about him, and I'm just his hands just to do this. You know, one of the things I also wanted you to have touch on was on the World Congress. What's going on there? Because we have our National Congress here, but what's going on for the whole world?
Wow, a lot. I mean, there are major meetings taking place over at the EU, trying to nudge things along. But there's also an organization. It's not far away from where you're at.
Really?
You're in Cheyenne, right?
Yeah, yes.
In Lakewood, Colorado, there's an organization called the World Constitution and Parliament Association.
Okay.
And I was invited to join that organization back in the 80s and got quite a wake-up call. These were people working very openly, well, behind the scenes, but among themselves openly, in trying to lay the foundation that would eventually help make world government and a world parliament and a world constitution possible. In fact, I've held in my hands a prototype copy of a world constitution that they have put together. It's called a constitution for the Federation of Earth. And it sounds like something out of Star Trek, doesn't it?
It does. It does.
But it's a real interesting point on a rabbit trail. One of the people who belonged to that organization years ago was one of the futurists that helped to conceive Star Trek. So probably some of the terminology used in that program is not a coincidence. But anyway, the organization had a lot of Nobel Prize winners, former UN officials, ambassadors, some really important people in it. And I'm trying to think. There's so much I could share about that organization, but I just want to use it as an example.
Sure.
At the time, at one point in time, I counted, I believe it was 400 different organizations, other organizations, whose leaders belonged to this organization, the World Constitution of Parliament Association. So it's kind of like spokes going out from a wheel, representing a major network. Some of the leaders of Greenpeace, for example, belonged. And, of course, that organization has millions of people that support it financially, and most of those people, I'm sure, have no clue that some of their leaders were belonging to this organization that was advocating and working toward world government. You had the World Council of Churches represented through its former president, Cynthia Waddell, who was affiliated with the organization. Dr. Inamullah Khan of Pakistan, who was the head of the World Muslim Congress at the time, he was one of the vice presidents of the organization. And so they really covered all the religions, all the political spectrums, trying to pull together and working toward a type of critical mass where they would become so influential through the media, through the UN, through politics, that their agenda would take hold and that people would begin to run with it. And so in and of themselves, they're not necessarily a powerful organization. They're just playing a certain role. They were laying the groundwork. And I think the last meeting I heard of, I think it was either the 11th or 12th meeting of the Provisional World Parliament that was held. So they've actually been holding dress rehearsal type of parliament meetings. All of this intended to lead up to ultimately a global government. And again, this is in Lakewood, Colorado, where most people wouldn't think anything's going on.
Yeah.
But the whole the Denver, Boulder, Lakewood area has unfortunately become a hotbed for New Agers and Eastern mystics.
Yes.
And there's a growing stronghold of occultists there. Colorado Springs has had a stronger Christian base, but Manitou Springs, which is also there, has drawn a lot of New Agers. So there's a real battle, a spiritual battle going on for the front range of the Rockies between Colorado Springs and Denver. And I believe it's going to be a major battleground leading into the New World Order because you've got both sides represented. But Satan is gaining a lot of ground there right now, and I don't want to be negative on this, but I don't see good things ahead for that part of the country. And I think it may happen fairly soon. I was at a meeting recently in Florida of 12 or 13 different watchmen from around the country. When I say watchmen, people who'd been in ministry for years, taking a stand for the Lord faithfully without scandal, and who really are sold out and committed to the Lord. And we all shared. We took turns sharing at this meeting what the Lord was laying on our hearts, and they were all in agreement that the time was short and that very soon things would begin to happen in this country, but that there would also be places of refuge. In fact, there was a couple there that had moved from California to a certain southern state, I won't mention it, and in that state, they were led by the Lord to develop a place of refuge because God told them that there would be people fleeing out of the big cities in the area, and they would need a place to come to. And they've got a huge facility now, a chicken farm with tons of water, food, whatnot. And I've come across other people in other parts of the country that have been led by the Lord to do the same thing, all of them out and away from the big cities. The coastal areas, I believe, will be eventually affected the most, but initially it could actually be in the heartland where the persecution becomes pretty intense. And I think Colorado is going to be one of the battleground states. So we all need to be prayed up and know what God wants us to do, and it's going to be a little bit different for every person. For some people, God's saying, become a place of refuge. Go outside of where you live. Get ready, because there are going to be people that are going to be fleeing the cities, and they're going to need a place to come to. Other people who've been quite outspoken and visible, God is directing some of them to get out of the country.
Mm-hmm.
And I know of some people right now doing that. And so it's going to be a little bit different for everybody, but the important thing is that each one of us as individuals are in tune with the Lord. And we've got to understand, when we stand before the Lord someday, nobody's going to be holding our hand. We're not going to be standing before Him as a group. We're going to be standing before Him as individuals. And so it's so important to have an individual relationship with Him and be obedient to Him as an individual, whatever He calls you to do. And if you're the head of a family, then you have an especially important duty and job to lead your family. Start being men. I don't even want to get started on this, but one thing that really bugs me is the high percentage of pansies there are in America now among American men. I can tell you, I know of dozens of men personally who come home from work and will spend 2 or 3 hours playing video games, men in their 30s and 40s. And rather than directing and teaching their families and leading their kids in the way of the Lord, and nothing wrong with a little bit of recreation, I'm not saying that, but I'm talking about people who are addicted to either video games or pornography or just entertainment, pursuing entertainment. And that's a big part of the problem, a lack of male leadership in this country. For every one man I know who's being a solid Christian leader, I know I'd say on average 3 women. I was years ago, I was speaking at a place in northeastern Colorado. It was way out in the boondocks. I forget the name of the town. And it was a church of a couple hundred. And there were only 3 or 4 men there that evening. There were a lot of, it was a pretty full church. But I'd say there are on the order of 100, 150 women, a number of teenagers, but just a few men. And I said, "Where are the men?" And the women teared up. They said, "We just can't get them interested. They do their rodeos. They do this and that. They're into drag racing. They're anything but the Lord." And so these women were basically having to become the spiritual leaders of their homes. And they weren't a bunch of women libbers. They wanted men to be leaders, but they just weren't.
Mm-hmm.
And so with the help of just a few men, they were trying to run that church. And they were gracious enough to have me in to share. And I see that all around the country. It's just men need to step it up, and they need to grow up and stop being babies and pansies.
Yeah.
And normally I can't believe I'm saying this. I don't know if I've ever done this before. It's just coming out of me today. I don't like name calling and all that, but I just some things have happened recently close to me that I've just seen this again, and so I'm kind of laying into men right now.
But okay.
I believe God wants me to tell men to be leaders of their families and get their act together. And so if you're hearing this message and you know I'm talking to you, do something about it for the sake of the Lord, not because I'm saying it.
You know, and that's why we wanted you to say that, because we wanted the Holy Spirit to speak on this program here, and whatever He wanted to say, that would get out. I've been really blessed with a wife. We'll be married 10 years in November, that we're really on the same track. We really have the same goals. We will think of the same thing. We'll do this. And so when we sold our house, we had bought this house where we're at now, and we hadn't even put our house up for sale. And we just felt that God told us to do it. We did it. We believed God. And within a week and a half later, we had our house sold. And so God made things work out. That being said, I had about 4 years ago, I had God spoke to me 3 different times in a dream. And I actually had was standing in the church, and I seen this invisible hand going through and picking out certain people that were kind of stragglers in the pews, but there was the majority of the people were up around the pastor as tight as they could. And I seen an invisible hand taking those other people that were stragglers out of the church. The second dream I had, I was actually going with a fire hose into the church, and there was all this dung and all this trash and that in the middle, and I was going to wash it away. But the leaders of that church said, "Don't touch it. This is how we like it." The third dream, I was in Israel with Perry Stone Ministries, and I was on the other side of this road looking at the church, which is called Pioneer Avenue. And there was a door in the dream, not in real life, and the door was open, and the pastor seeing me, and he said, "You are no longer welcome here." And he slammed the door, and the brick started falling, and God said, "Now you're on the pioneer side." And so we stepped out at that time and went into a home group. We just said, "Okay, God, we believe that you're telling us to leave, not the church, but the church buildings, the way things have been done." And so that's what we've been doing, just going, "Okay, God, we feel that you told us to do this, and this is the things that we're stepping on doing."
Well, there in churches in America today, among the denominations, what I have found is the direction that an individual church body is taking depends so much on that local leadership. It doesn't have as much to do with the denominations, but with the leadership. And, you know, I know some pastors that are very godly men and good leaders, but I know more who are real stinkers and who have created just huge problems around their egos and are causing division in the church and teaching unsound doctrine just to puff themselves up. And that's got to come to an end. I think it will soon. Many people are leaving those churches now because they're starting to see through that. Mm-hmm. There is a trend towards smaller fellowships where people know each other better, and there's more of a family atmosphere where people can be more involved in each other's lives. You know, Jesus discipled his disciples. I mean, he walked with them daily. They saw him interact, and they learned from him. And there's so little of that today because people come together sometimes once a week for an hour, and then they all go their separate ways. And I think something that's really been lacking in the church is discipleship, a closeness among the believers and also in the smaller group setting. And along with that, pastors who are more than just preachers, pastors who really shepherd their flocks. And that gets to be difficult to do once a church is over, say, 200, 250 people. It's just, mm-hmm. at that point, it seems like pastors tend to become more preachers. And they're not always in touch the way they need to be with their flock. And I've seen this time and time again. Not to say that there aren't some pastors out there who are able to do it. I know some high-energy pastors that hardly ever sleep. It's amazing what all they're able to do. I don't know how they do it. But generally speaking, it's the smaller churches, the closeness that comes with that, the discipleship, and the intimacy I with the Lord. I think that's going to be the wave of the future in this country, probably even in the form of an underground church, because I think true Christians here in the near future are going to be going underground. They're not going to be able to continue to speak openly like we are on this program today.
Oh, I do agree, and that's what's sad is we're seeing everything about America that was built on, because we have a big steam engine in this one park, and it's one of the biggest ones they ever built. And I look at it, and I go, you know, all this work that people did, you know, 50, 100 years ago, all the stuff they did, I love to go to the mountains and look at history, old log cabins, and I look at all the stuff that people did. They dug in mines, and they did all this work, and now it's like it's all going away. I mean, all this... You know, I guess I don't know how to explain it, but it just seemed like it's almost like the work was in vain.
Yeah, you know, you see that around the country in different places where people put their everything into something, and now it doesn't matter; it's gone. And I guess the lesson from all that is, you know, if we pursue temporal things, we're going to get temporal rewards mm-hmm. that last only for a time. If we pursue eternal things, our rewards are going to be eternal, and we're going to be blessed seeing our work on this earth come to fruition and playing out throughout eternity. And so the wise man and the wise woman puts their main focus not on the things of this earth, but the things of heaven. Mm-hmm. And I've heard some people say, you can become so heavenly minded, you're no good on this earth. And I hear what they're saying, but you know what? In today's age, that's very rarely the problem. Most people lack a holy reverence for the Lord. It's not that they have too much of it. In fact, I think that is one of the biggest problems in our country is that we no longer fear the Lord. Yeah. We you know, pray to him for things that we want, and all of us do that some, but really we ought to be coming under his authority and saying, Lord, what do you want from me? And I'm willing to do whatever you ask. And that's not the way it is in most cases. We're just not where we need to be with the Lord. But I just want to encourage people who are listening, again, that there is still time. The fact that you're listening to this program means there is still some time. It might be short, but things can still be turned around. And the Lord wants to get your attention, and he wants to work through you in the time that's left. There's a lot to do. The field is ripe, but the workers are few. And so I just plead with you to listen to the Lord and get serious about him and come in line with his agenda and stop pursuing your own.
One of the things I really find out, the biggest thing I'm seeing, at least for me, is I see in the world with Christians is a lack of trust in God providing for them. And what I mean by this is giving out of their abundance to help another ministry or somebody else, and realizing, okay, God, I'm going to give this to you because I know that this person needs it, but I also know that you're going to take care of my needs because I'm helping this person. And I see a lack of trust in that area of God with people trusting God.
So you're right on that. You know, God is faithful, and I left my job in the 1980s to pursue getting this message out. And I'll tell you, right off the bat, it really tested our faith. The first 6 years were difficult till my book actually came out. We thought it would take 2 years, took 6 years because of all the things that happened. Mm-hmm. But I remember one point in time, we were down to nothing, and we were faced for the first time with not being able to pay a bill. It was going to be due in a few days, and we didn't have it. We didn't have the funds, and my wife said, what do we do? I said, well, I really believe we're doing what God has called us to do. He's confirmed it in numerous ways. We've done all that we can. He knows we're not lazy. Let's pray to him and ask him to provide. Mm-hmm. And so I think it was a Friday night in bed, we held hands and just said a simple prayer. Lord, you know that we need $200 and we don't know how to bring it in or where it might come from, but you do. Please provide for us so that we can pay this bill coming up. And on Sunday morning, my wife Audrey, who was in the choir, opened up her choir folder, and there was an envelope inside. Now, at the church at the time where we were going, they had slots where choir folders go in, and then they had doors that closed over the top of those. And during the week, that whole cabinet was locked up, and you couldn't get into it. And then Sunday mornings, they'd unlock it and open it up, and everyone could retrieve their choir folders out of there. So somebody that morning must have put something in there after it was unlocked. And the envelope inside her choir folder had our names written on the outside. It just said, wow. Gary and Audrey. So with great anticipation, she opens it up, and it's a short letter. It said, Dear Gary and Audrey, God has blessed me tremendously over the years. I just want to share this small gift with you. Remember, always trust in the Lord, and he will provide.
Wow.
And there were 10 $20 bills inside for exactly $200. And we didn't tell one person about that. Nobody knew except the Lord.
Wow.
And so she came into the Sunday school room where I was sitting and tried to explain to me what just happened, and then she couldn't talk. She got overwhelmed with and she was tearing up and began crying, and so she handed it to me, and I read it. And I thought, how awesome is our God? And I can tell you one story after another like that, how God has provided. We've been in full-time ministry now as a Christian author and speaker for 21 years, starting in late 1991, and we've never seen more than about 2 to 3 months ahead, maybe a couple of times a few months further than that, but it's been a walk of faith the whole way, but God has never let us down. We've eaten very well, but you know what? But even if we lost our house and didn't have food for a while, God is still good.
Mm-hmm.
And he sees the eternal picture. He knows what reward we'll get in eternity. And sometimes as individuals, we live in the here and now. And to us, the only thing that's important is, you know, our next meal and being warm, or if it's hot outside, being cold. you know, that's just how we're wired and how we think. But God is good, and he knows our needs, and he wants us to trust and rely on him. But he also wants us to work hard.
Mm-hmm.
And if we do our level best and serve him and don't sit on our duffs and we're out there doing what he called us to do, he will open the doors and make possibilities available that lead to the income that comes in that we need to be able to make it. We've seen him do that time and time again with us.
That's exciting. I really do want to honor your time. We have about 13 minutes. And I know that, you know, there's things that, you know, God will speak to you personally you won't share, but is there anything that you could share that God is speaking to you right now that maybe might edify those out there that are listening?
Well, I've already touched on a number of things that are on my heart. But I'd say over the last 8 months or so, early in the year, the Lord opened up an opportunity for us to speak in Germany, just north of Frankfurt.
Mm-hmm.
And I still have some relatives over there on my dad's side and my mother's side. And I was so hoping that I'd have an opportunity to somehow share the gospel with them. And it was so neat to see them show up and come to the conference. And and I believe that the Lord put it on my heart that this would be the last time that I would see them. And so it was a bit of an emotional time for me because I went there with that, just that very strong impression. And so I wanted to make every moment count. And God afforded us those opportunities. And there were times when I was able to express myself in German better than I would have 20 years ago. I'd hardly spoken any German in years. And it's like the Lord brought things back to me. It was really supernatural how the Lord worked. And we got into deep discussions on a number of things. And I believe the ministering work of the Holy Spirit was done. I say all that to say this. I believe that the time is very short, and some people, some relatives that listeners may see in the next couple of weeks, they may not ever see them again. You know, unless they're daily in your lives, a number of months or years may pass, and you will not see them again. And you need to make the most of every opportunity and take it very seriously. And don't put the pressure on yourself. You know, it's God. God is the mover of hearts, but we have to be willing to be the vessels to speak the truth in love. And we can't be lazy in that regard, and we shouldn't be fearful. I mean, what are we afraid of? You know, they're humans. They can maybe get upset with us for talking about things they don't want to talk about. But if they close that door and don't want to hear anymore, let them close the door. That's not for us to say or do. We are to do our best to share, and not just to share, but to live out Christ before them. That we need to be careful not to be hypocrites, but that we walk our talk as much as possible. And I know we all make mistakes, and God understands that. None of us are perfect. But to the greatest degree possible, we need to set our minds to be diligent and to walk our talk. And that will lead to opportunities to share, and we need to make the most of those opportunities. When we got back from Germany, I had some other speaking engagements, and then we had a passion play that our church has put on in our county for several years. And my wife has been one of the lead singers in that passion play, and after it was all over, she said, "You know what, the Lord made very clear to me, this is the last time I'm singing at this passion play."
Hmm.
And this type of thing has happened repeatedly throughout this year now on several different occasions where it's as if we're saying our goodbyes. And I don't know what it all means. I just think that the time might be shorter than what we think, and that, again, that some people in our lives, it may be the last time we see them. And so all that to say we need to make the most of every opportunity and redeem the time, be faithful to the Lord, and he will bless us abundantly, spiritually speaking, and he will also provide for our physical needs, whatever he needs to do to make it possible for us to live effectively for him.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. I mean, I really appreciate you doing this because I know that we want to touch as many people as possible, and there could be somebody out there in Africa that needs to know Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, but never heard it. But just by happenstance, they got this show, they don't know who it was, and they listened, and they received Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. We could touch on virtually, who knows, millions of people. That one song by Ray Bolts that came out years ago called Thank You for Giving the Lord, I believe that your time and my time here is well spent for the kingdom.
I totally agree, and it's an honor and a privilege to serve the Lord and to be used by him. There is no greater joy, no greater honor in the world. And people that that understand that and grasp it, it's just life transforming, because we're working for the ultimate boss, mm-hmm. the creator of the universe. You know, on the lighter side of things, we have a friend who is flying on an airplane somewhere, and the man sitting next to her was completely engrossed in his computer and wouldn't look or talk to her or anything. And so she finally said, "Wow, you must be really important working on that computer. What do you do?" And so he shared a little bit, and then it got quiet, and he asked her, "Who do you work for?" And she said, "I work for the most powerful person in the world." And she's saying this as a believer. And it led into about a 10-minute conversation, and it ended with her being able to share with him about the Lord. But it really is true. We work for the most powerful, all-knowing, generous, loving being in the world, our God and Creator, who knows us better than anyone else. And if that doesn't excite us, you know, something's just wrong. We need to pray that God would give us a heart and give us excitement and enthusiasm for Him, that we would want to serve Him and know Him better, because it is a privilege, and it's for all those who are willing to receive, who are willing to hear the Lord and respond. It's there for the taking. Jesus died for our sins. He paid the penalty for our sins, so that by believing that He did that for us, thereby we don't have to pay the price and spend eternity in hell. We can go to heaven. God allows us entrance into heaven based on what we do with Jesus Christ. We either accept Him or we reject Him. And how foolish it would be to reject a free gift that God has put before us by sending His only Son to die in our place and pay the penalty for us. It's very simple, actually, mm-hmm. but people just... many don't want to believe it, or they are too proud. They want to believe somehow they can earn their way into heaven, and others don't believe there is a heaven or hell at all, and they will be quite surprised on that day. But it is a privilege, and I thank the Lord for getting hold of my life years ago, and it's been very fulfilling and rewarding.
Well, Gary, I have one other question to ask you, and then I want to have you share your website and also your newsletter. And the question I have, this is kind of an offshoot. What are your thoughts, and what have you heard about the Iraqi dinar?
Depending on what happens in Iraq, it could increase in value. But as close as we are getting to war in the Middle East, and I think it may be just around the corner, and depending how Iraq plays into that, That could put a damper on everything. So if I owned dinars, I wouldn't put my whole future hope in that. Let's put it that way, because but if there's some time left, and if the Iraqi currency is able to go public in a major way, and there are some peaceful times that prevail in Iraq, then yes, the currency would be worth something in the fairly near future. But if Iran and Israel and Syria get into it, and Iraq ends up being in the middle of that somehow, all bets are off. So, and again, that's one reason we don't want to put our trust in this earthly wealth. But yet, the Lord does want us to be wise and prudent and do what we can to multiply our investment and use it for His honor and glory.
It's just something I've been hearing a lot. Gary, could you share about your newsletter that you have on your website?
Yes, we started doing a newsletter years ago because we get so many emails we can't possibly respond to them, maybe 10% of them, and so our newsletter is our way of being in touch with people. And if we hear from people asking us the same questions over and over, then we know we need to respond on that particular subject, and so we use our newsletter to do that. And it also helps to underwrite our existence so that we are able to continue forward as a ministry. And we're very thankful to the Lord for that and for people who are willing to subscribe. It is a subscription-based newsletter. We do post some of the articles free of charge on our website, so people can go and look at some of our back articles, including one that I wrote last month called Final Warning that I encourage people to read. You can go to our website. It is www.garykah, that's spelled GARYKAH.org, garykah.org. And tell friends about it, too. Go to our website. We have a lot of resources on there. And if the Lord so leads, we'd love for you to become a subscriber and help to underwrite our ministry to keep doing what we're doing, and also benefit from the information we put out on a quarterly basis through that newsletter. And we do fully document everything we say, and a lot of times we actually reproduce the documents themselves in our newsletter. It's about a 20-pager. And we don't ever want to be embarrassed. We want to put together something of high quality that would honor the Lord, and that is our goal.
And also mention your books real quick here before we go.
My first book was En Route to Global Occupation. It talked about the economic, political, and religious aspects of the One World Movement and kind of how they work together and who some of the key players are and what they are wanting to do. By the way, if you read that book today, even though it was written 20 years ago, everything I wrote and warned about then is happening right now. It's more timely than ever. My second book is called The New World Religion, and it deals with the religious deception that is behind this New World Order movement and what we need to be on guard about. It also explains the occult Eastern mysticism underpinnings of the New World Order movement. It helps you to understand the difference between occultism and Christianity, because the lines are being blurred now by some people because they're teaching a false Christianity. We need to understand enough about the occult so that we can steer clear of it while really steeping ourselves and versing ourselves in the Bible and memorizing Bible passages. And I think if we do that, if we make every effort we can to be discerning, the Lord through His Holy Spirit living in us won't let us go wrong.
Well, Gary, thank you very much. Would you mind in the near future that I could have you like maybe 6 months from now back on?
I'll be happy to do that.
Okay.
I am getting ready to go on a sabbatical because I've had some recent surgeries and I have one more. And God has chosen this time for us to take a little bit of a break just to get some recovery time. And so once we come back from that sabbatical, I would be happy to.
Gary, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Listen, hey, have a very good weekend.
You too, Barry. God bless you.
We'll talk to you soon.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye. That was Gary Kaw. That's GaryKaw.org. Now, also, the next time we have a speaker on, we're looking at having Richard Madison. Madison, that's international evangelist and author, raised from the dead, and also a book that's called End Time Prophecy Revealed, talking about just multiple different things and that are kind of going on in the world. And also, the reason why I mentioned the Rocky Dinar with Gary was I've been hearing a lot of things about that. And so, you know, you have to be led by God to see if that's something you want to do. Anyways, with current things with my work and computers and stuff like that that's going on with schooling, just keep watching the website or also go to barry-julie.blogspot.com. You can check up on news. You can check up on updates as I'm doing shows. But you can go to endtimetalkradio.com and you can watch out for new shows that are coming up. You can also go into archives, listen to some shows. I did have some older shows, but during constraints with bandwidth, it's been kind of tough having them all up there. So maybe as time goes on, I'll put some old ones back up there if somebody wants to hear something or if I think it was really interesting to bring it back up. And so you can kind of watch what's going on at endtimetalkradio.com. That's the main one part if you want to find out what shows. If you want to see news, that's barry-julie.blogspot.com. You can keep up with those things and kind of see how things are going. We'll hope to have Richard Madison on in the next few weeks. We'll see how it goes. Just keep watching. And once we get a date set, I'll put them up on the website there of the dates. And maybe we can do a live show with Ustream. The only problem is they throw commercials up there, so that's kind of a problem. But you can always listen to archives in the full length. We never ask for any donations. We just ask that you would donate to those who we have on, whether it's Gary Kaw or Rick Wiles with True News or multiple different other people like Rob Skiba, L.A. Marzulli. They believe that this is something that God's called us to do as a free service. And we just pray that End Time Talk Radio will get you into the different areas that God wants you to find out who's speaking about what, so that you can be educated to current events and that you will be awakened to how close we're seeing Jesus soon return. Anyways, we'll talk to you as soon as we can next time on End Time Talk Radio. See you next time.